والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه أما بعد يقول الحق تبارك وتعالى والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر والفجر وليالي العشر والشفع والوتر والضحى والليل إذا سجى and many other أقسام is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swearing by his creation and it's for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the creator to swear by anything that he wishes to swear by and it's not for us to swear by anything or anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his infinite knowledge and wisdom directs our attention to the greatness and the importance of these items that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by. In many places of the Qur'an we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by time. For example, when he says wal asr, asr means time, and it also means the time of salat al-asr. Al-fajr is the break of dawn, and it's also the time for salat al-fajr. Al-duha is the sun rise, and that's also the time of salat al-duha. And many other places that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by time, which are increments of time, which are segments of time, in which our deeds fall. Means that these are the times that our deeds take place. And these deeds could be the good deeds or could be the bad deeds. But in reality, our life in general is divided into segments, days. And some of the scholars define that by saying, يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ مَا أَنْتَ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مُجْتَمِعًا كُلَّمَا ذَهَبَ بَعْضُهَا ذَهَبَ بَعْضُكَ O son of Adam, you are nothing but a group of days, time periods. Every time part of it goes away, part of you means that part of your life goes away. And as we know, the deeds that we perform day in and day out are going to determine whether we are successful in the purpose, in achieving or accomplishing the purpose and the objective to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us or not. And that's going to determine our eternal dwelling place in the hereafter, whether it's going to be Jannah, عرضها السماوات والأرض, a paradise, the width of which is the heavens and the earth, or العياذ بالله, the hellfire. So therefore, the significance of time is determined by how much emphasis and how much understanding we have on the objective and the purpose behind our creation. In a nutshell, to sum it up, time equals life. Unlike the Western notion where they say time is money, time is not money. Time is life. Money comes and goes. You could be old, you could be young. It does not, it's no factor. It could be to some degree a determining factor of how wealthy or not so wealthy you are. But at the end, if you don't use this wealth for that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that which builds you the palace in a paradise in the hereafter, that wealth is no good. To the contrary, that wealth could be your enemy. Could be the cause for your detriment in this life and in the hereafter. So time equals life. So therefore those who are using their time, they are using their life. And those who are wasting their time, they literally wasting their life. Now we come to the statement of the Prophet ﷺ when he says in Sahih al-Bukhari, يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ مَا أَنْتَ when he said, when the Prophet ﷺ says, نِعْمَتَانِ مَغْبُونٌ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ Two bounties that many, or the overwhelming majority of people, are مغبون. The word مغبون means مظلوم. Means they are oppressing themselves, they're causing injustice to themselves. That they have the health, and they have the time, and they are not using that to benefit themselves. نِعْمَتَانِ مَغْبُونٌ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ الصِّحَّةُ وَالْفَرَارُ صِحَّة means health. As we look around, we see that not everybody's healthy. Some people are unable to make their sujood, so they pray in a chair. They're unable to make their ruku'ah, so they pray sitting down. Some people are not able to come to the masjid. Some people are not able to fast. Some people are not able to do many things that the average person is able to do. And it's been said, and you know, as words of wisdom that we ought to keep in our heads, is that الصحة تاج على رؤوس الأصحاء لا يراه إلا المرضى that for those who take their health for granted health is like a crown on the heads of those who are healthy and none can see that but the unhealthy those who have lost their health Those who are unable to perform their day-to-day activities or their day-to-day ibadat and acts of worship, or whatever chores, needs, necessities they need to perform for themselves or for their families. So, as-sihha wal-faragh. Faragh is that many people have plenty of time on their hands. They're not busy doing anything, but they choose to remain idle. They choose not to make headways in their ibadah or in their livelihood, you know, to benefit themselves and to benefit others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by al-asr. In Surah Al-Asr, a surah that al-Shafi'i rahimahullah said, لَوْ عَمِلَ النَّاسُ بِهَا لَكَفَتْهُمْ. If people were to understand this surah and to apply it, use these words of wisdom and apply it to themselves, it would have been sufficient for them. So let's just briefly look at Surah Al-Asr and what it says. And in Surah Al-Asr, in spite of its, shortness, in spite of how short it is, it has so much wisdom that the Shafi'i said if people were to apply this surah and what's in it, the words of wisdom in this surah to their lives, it would have been sufficient for them to use their time effectively and to be successful in this dunya and in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. If we just to understand this one statement, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by al-asr time, and he says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Man at large is at a loss. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped here, everybody would be at a loss. Everybody will, iyadu billah, will be doomed to the hellfire. So what is the path to salvation? The path to salvation is the exemption that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made in the latter part of this surah. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. So these are four elements that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us how to use our time effectively. How to use our health effectively. The first of which, al-Iman, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Iman billahi, wa malaikatihi, wa kutubihi, wa rusulihi, wal yawm al-akhir, wal qada, khayruhu wa sharruhu. One could say, well, we know this. We as Muslims, we know this. Yes, we know it for the most part, ijmalan, in the collective sense of the word. In the collective sense of saying, La ilaha illallah, that I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, none is worthy of worship but Him. But in La ilaha illallah, there is al-Iman al-Tafsili, means that the detailed type of Iman. Meaning that what are the conditions of La ilaha illallah? If you ask the average Muslim, they may not know that. What are the negations of La ilaha illallah? What are the divine names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And what do they mean? And how can we emulate? And how can we emulate where emulation or copying is not only permitted, but is required of us? How can we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with every quality and every trait that He has, with every name that He has? This is Iman Tafsili, and the list goes on and on and on. Similarly, al-Iman billahi wa malaikatihi. What is it, our belief in the angels? Who are they? What they're created for? What they do? What they've created of? وَكُتُبِهِ. What are the prior revelations? What did they come to teach people? Do we believe in them? Do we not? Of course, as Muslims, we are obligated to believe in them, in everything that came in its original form. وَرُسُولِهِ. Believe in all of the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of the prophets, to read about them, to emulate them, to understand the qasas, the stories of the Qur'an, as it talks about Musa and Isa and Ibrahim and all of the prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Qur'an in details. And how we can follow their role model. And how do we understand Islam? By way of their actions, and by their way of their statements, and by way of their da'wah. How to call to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How to enjoin the good and forbid the evil, and rest in the pillars of Iman. So all of that, of course, if we were to talk about that in a detailed manner, will take us weeks, perhaps months. Depending on the level of details you want to talk about. So this is an investment of our time. To a certain level, we are required, it's a fard ayn. We are, each and every one of us, is required to understand and to apply up to a certain level. Below that, our iman would be insufficient, would be deficient, would not be suitable enough for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from us. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many places in the Qur'an, when He talks about the Iman, He talks about following this Iman with righteous deeds. And the righteous deeds are beyond what we can really enumerate. So we're talking about Salah, And of course, talking about Salat al-Jama'ah, talking about the fiqh of Salah, how to pray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. What is the difference between praying and establishing the Salah? Establishing the Salah is a far more comprehensive way of understanding our Salah. Meaning that establishing the Salah with its khushu'ah, with its pillars, with its sunans, with its preparation, so on and so forth. وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ. And attain purity. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. How do we purify ourselves? How do we rid ourselves of its evils and its whims and desires? How do we bring that under control? These are all acts of ibadat. Even the acts of ibadat are not limited, or the righteous deeds are not limited to just the religious aspect of things. For example, going after your rizq with moderation is a requirement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it obligatory upon each and every one of us who have the capacity to pursue their rizq. For example, one merchant was known to be among the righteous, but had a bit of a misunderstanding of what it's mean to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by seeking after your rizq, your sustenance. So he was traveling to do, you know, trade. So he would buy goods and he would bring it back and he would sell it. So on his way, he found two birds. One of them could not see and could not fly. And he saw the other bird would bring him its rizq and would feed it. So he said, then why am I doing this travel? Why am I, you know, undertaking this tremendous risk and hardship in order to earn my rizq? Why don't I just be like this bird who cannot see and cannot fly, and I just wait for my rizq to come here? So when he returned, his friend asked him, he said, that was such a short journey, what happened? So he told him what happened and what he saw. He said, so I'm just going to sit tight here and wait for my rizq to come to me. He said, subhanAllah, you've accepted for yourself to be like a blind and handicapped bird, and you would not accept for yourself to be the provider. In other words, it's not for a Muslim to accept to be a handicapped and blind if they're not. Huh? In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. Imagine this. The most beloved among people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who are most beneficial to others. Meaning that if you're able to show people how to do good, how to do righteousness, how to practice piety, how to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how to learn His sharia, how to help them if they are indebted, to ransom them from that debt, pay it off. How if there's a dispute between two people, to resolve this dispute for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a widow is unable to earn her sustenance, if an orphan is in need of help, if a person who is incapacitated is in need of help, this is better than doing a qiyam in the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, qiyam al-layl, for 1 month. The Prophet ﷺ says so in the hadith, and it's an authentic hadith. And whoever is able to put a smile on his brother's face, that is also among the righteousness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So if you measure yourself how beneficial you are to your Muslim brothers and your Muslim sisters and to your Muslim children who have no parents or those who are in need of your help, then you are closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than many other people. So ibadah is not something that is self-centric. It's focused on me, my qiyam, my recitation of the Qur'an, my salah, no, I ought to have part of that performed, definitely. But the biggest aspect of the ibadah, the most rewarding, is what's mentioned in the hadith, أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. That those who are the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are most beneficial to others, not to themselves. And, you know, I've learned one lesson during the hajj, where one scholar was giving a lecture. He said, it is not about you when you go for hajj. It's about what you can do for others. It's about what you can do for others. In other words, don't make your ibadah self-centric. Just focus on yourself. Okay? Feel, you know, the agony and the struggle that people undergo, especially those who are much weaker than you. So don't use your strength to overcome their efforts as they endeavor towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Certainly you are endeavoring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His mercy. So be merciful on those who are less, who are weaker than you, or don't have as much strength as you do. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Among the صَالِحَاتِ is بِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. Enjoying blood relationships. and being kind and compassionate and responsible towards your old parents. Being kind to your neighbor. Being kind to the orphan, to the widow. Being helpful to the poor. And so on and so forth. Our ibadat in Islam are beyond enumeration. But, you know, I just wanted to mention that even to the extent that Abdullah ibn Umar used to say that أحتسب على الله القيام كما أحتسب على الله الركود أو كما قال رضي الله عنه, means that I look forward to the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when I'm doing قيام الليل. And when I lie down in bed to get some rest, I also look forward for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because I need that rest to do the qiyam, and to work, and to help my family, and to tend to my children, and to teach people the knowledge, and to seek knowledge, right? So all of that is an act of ibadah. Similarly, the 8 or 10 hours that we spend at work every day, we look forward for the ajr from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we are trying to suffice ourselves and our families, and to build the masajid and establish the places of da'wah for the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of our efforts. So we need to rest and we need to work and we need to do many things. And all of these are acts of ibadah. To the extent the scholars say, مَا لَا يَتِمُّ الْوَاجِبُ بِهِ فَهُوَ وَاجِبُ. What does that mean? Meaning that if the Muslim ummah is in need of food and no one is taking the time to learn about agriculture, no one is taking the time to sow the land, no one is, then all of the ummah becomes sinful. All of the ummah becomes sinful. So learning the sciences of agriculture and how to produce for the ummah, be it food, or be it the purification of water, or be it partaking in the industrial revolution, or be it partaking in the health industry, or any of that, if the entire ummah is lagging behind, then the entire ummah is sinful. مَا لَا يَتِمُّ الْوَاجِبُ إِلَّا بِهِ فَهُوَ وَاجِبُ. To the extent our shahwa, our desire, our whims, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed as an intricate need that each and every one of us has. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَفِي بِضْعِ أَحَدِكُمْ صَدَقَةٌ. Sadaqah for yourself and sadaqah for your spouse when you have that intimate relationships. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he mentioned that, the sahaba looked at him, even that we get rewarded for. He said, do you see if you do it the unlawful way? Meaning that if you fornicate, would you get punished? They said, yes. Then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, then if you do it the right way, and if you do it within the boundaries of the sharia, then you get rewarded for it. So you can see that, you know, the concept of ibad in our deen, and I'm just mentioning this in a nutshell, is beyond our imagination. But what we need to remember, day in and day out, to make the intention. To make the intention. A lot of us forget that. You know, we're rushing to get here and we're rushing to get there. We're trying to what? To invest our time, our life. But sometimes we forget to make a very simple ibadah. That all it requires just for you to pause for a few seconds and say, this is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My intention is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My intention is to make this as a ibadah. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Then, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. None of us is infallible. So we all make mistakes. And we should not be bashful from one another, you know, to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this the number one prerequisite for this ummah to be the middle nation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are the best nation put out to humanity, enjoining the good, forbidding the evil, and believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that if we enjoin the good and forbid the evil and not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we get no credit for that. We get no credit for that. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is advancing, enjoining the good and forbidding the evil, ahead of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to signify how important enjoining the good and forbidding the evil is. To the extent that if we as Muslims do not enjoin the good and forbid the evil, and we are in a state of iman, in a state of ibadah, as we learn from the town that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel to destroy. And in it there was a devotee, one who's a believer, and one who did righteous deeds, but did not enjoin the good, did not forbid the evil. The angel went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying, oh Allah, in it, in this town that you just commanded me to destroy, is this devotee. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, bihi fabda'u. Begin with him. فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَتَمَعَّرْ وَجْهَهُ فِيَّ قَطْ. Because he never, in spite of seeing, sin is being committed. and the sanctity of the deen is being violated, and the sanctity of the places of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being violated, he has never moved, you know, anything, that never moved him to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. He just remained focused on his ibadah, self-centric in his ibadah, just doing his qiyam and his siyam and his ruku' and his sujood, thinking this is the deen. This is only part of the deen. This is not the whole deen. What these ibadat are to produce in us is the passion and the jealousy for our deen and the motivation to enjoin the good and forbid the evil and to establish the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth as He made us a khalifa, a vicegerent on this earth. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. And we know that. We all preach patience. And we all command each other to be patient. Have patience, have patience, have patience. And that is what needed, because you can do the first three. And if you're not persevering patience, just like we saw in one of the battles where the Prophet ﷺ looked at a person who was fighting fi sabilillah, and he was fighting so fiercely, and he was so brave, and everybody was marveling about how brave and how courageous this man is, and how he's fighting fi sabilillah, and everybody was alarmed when they heard the Prophet ﷺ saying he is from among the dwellers of the hellfire. Everybody was alarmed, everybody got scared. This is a Prophet of Allah, he's fighting fi sabilillah, he's showing so much courage and braveness and so on and so forth. And then the Prophet ﷺ did not say anything. When the man died, of course, before he died, he was injured. And one of the believers kept on watching him to see why the Prophet ﷺ said he's among the dwellers of the hellfire. And the man, as he got injured, he did not persevere in patience upon his wounds. So what he did, he put his sword in the ground with the sharp edge of the sword facing up. He leaned on his sword and he killed himself. The man came to report to the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. I said, I bear witness that you are the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, why is that? He said, the man who said he's among the dwellers of the hellfire, he killed himself. Look, after all that he's done, he did not do number four in Salat al-Asr. وَتَوَاصَلُ بِالصَّبْرِ. That you must persevere in patience. Patience upon the calamities and the tribulations that we undergo day in and day out. Patience upon the decree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined for us to undergo. Patience upon the ibadah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made obligatory upon us. Patience upon the sinful behavior that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbidden us from attaining. All of that requires patience. So we can be the best of devotees, the best of believers, the best of those who give da'wah fi sabilillah, enjoin the good, forbid the evil, and then we fall short of persevering patience. You get to open and say, this is too much, I give it up. That is the first step towards lawsul iyadu billah. So in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us how to invest our time. In this surah, we begin to understand why Shafi'i rahimahullah, when he said, لو عمل الناس بها لكفتهم. If people were to apply this surah and understand it and work with these words of advice, it would be sufficient for them. Now, we come to the last part, which is why do people waste their time? And why do people waste their health? Why do they take that time and that health for granted? Number one, not understanding the purpose for their creation. If one doesn't understand the purpose of why they've been created, then the time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them for this creation is not going to be invested wisely. Just like one who doesn't understand the value of money. They're going to go squander it until they run out and they come and say, wait a minute, I'm broke. I have no money to pay my bills. I have no money to do anything now. Now they begin to understand the value of money. Right? Or one who works their entire lives and they never save anything. And they get to their old age where their productive life begins to severely diminish. And they begin to realize that they're not able to earn enough money, enough living to sustain, you know, their lives and to sustain those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed in their custody. So not understanding the purpose will inevitably cause one to waste time. Also, not understanding the value of time, not understanding that time is life. يَبْنَ آدَمْ مَا أَنْتَ إِلَّا أَيَّامٌ مُجْتَمِعًا. O son of Adam, you're nothing but a group of days. What makes up a month is days. What makes up a week is days. What makes up a year is days. And we oftentimes measure our lifespan with years. So therefore, 356 days have just gone by. Another 356 days, another 3. So now I'm 30, 40, 50, 60, 70. And the Prophet ﷺ tells us what? أَعْمَارُ أُمَّتِي مَا بَيْنَ سِتِّينَ وَسَبْعِينَ. The ages of my ummah between 60 and 70. You can multiply that by, you know, of course we go by the lunar calendar, not, which is the Hijri, not the solar calendar. So if we do the math correctly, those who say that they're 60, they're really, you know, they're shortchanging themselves 10, 11 days out of every year. So you take that 60 and you multiply it by 10, right? That's 600, you divide that into 29 days, you've added to your life so many days, so many years without realizing that, right? But the Prophet ﷺ, when he mentioned this hadith, the only valid calendar that we use that all of our ibadat are based on is the lunar calendar, not the solar calendar. So أعمار أمتي ما بين 60 و 70, between 60 and 70 years. وقليل ما يزيد عن ذلك. قليل means a few that will go beyond the 7 years, and we mentioned that if you reach 60 or 70, and so now you can really account for every day that you know you have. Abdullah ibn Umar used to say, إذا أصبحت فلا تنتظر المساء وإذا أمسيت فلا تنتظر الصباح. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala returns your soul to you after sleeping and you're able to make it till the morning, do not wait to fulfill your obligation to invest your time in that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the evening. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extends your day and your age to reach that evening, do not wait until the morning, because there are ibadat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do during the day. And there are ibadat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do at night. So do not confuse the day and the night. Huh? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ آيَتَيْنِ فَمَحَوْنَا آيَةَ اللَّيْلِ وَجَعَلْنَا آيَةَ النَّهَارِ مُبْصِرًا. That the day and the night are two ayat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are ibadat that are designated for the day, and there are ibadat that are designated for the night. So you do the ibadat of the day in the day, and you do the ibadat of the night in the night. So not understanding the value of time will inevitably cause one to take it for granted. And then the kafir says what? حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتِ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. When they realize that they are at time, and they haven't done anything, they have not, you know, invested, you know, their time in that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that which makes them successful in the hereafter, they say, oh Allah, return me. Return me, give me some more time. That's really what you're saying, effectively. When you say, return me, give me time. If somebody, is not performing in their jobs, in their professions, and they get to a point where the boss says, you're fired. Say, well, give me time. Give me time. He's returned me to my job, extend my time period, and I'll show you what I can do. Some bosses may be forgiven, some are not. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it obligatory upon himself that no soul will live, not even one moment, beyond that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for it. So, قَالَ رَبِّ يَا حَسْرَةَ عَلَى مَا فَرَّطْتُ فِي جَنْبِ اللَّهِ. That's what the disbeliever will say on Judgment Day. Woe to me, I have really wasted my time, I did not invest it fi sabilillah. So are they regretting the fact that they've wasted their time, they've wasted their life, right? So not understanding the value of this time will inevitably cause tremendous levels of regret, even for the Muslim, even for the believer. There's not the believer who would regret more in the hereafter than not doing that extra tasbih, and that extra rak'ah, and that extra sajda, and that extra sadaqah, and that extra day of fasting. Even the believer would have regrets. That's why the Day of Judgment, one of the names, is Yawmun Nadama. When they receive all these rewards for such small acts of righteousness, they will blame themselves. Why didn't I do more? I could have contributed more, I could have prayed more, I could have recited the Qur'an more, I could have sought a path of knowledge that will enable me to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that's a regret, and the regret of the disbeliever is another. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to the disbelievers as the true losers. قُلْ إِنَّ الْخَاسِرِينَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَهْلِهِمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The true losers are those who've lost themselves. To what? They've lost their place in paradise, and they've lost themselves to the hellfire, لِيَعْدِ اللَّهِ. وَأَهْلِهِمْ, in addition to that, they've lost their families. Because one who usually wastes themselves, right? Because we are examples for our children, and they follow. Right? So one who truly wastes their time, they are teaching their children and their offsprings to waste their time as well. So they are, chances are, oftentimes will end up also being losers. قُلْ إِنَّ الْخَاسِرِينَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَهْلِيهِمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَلَا ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينَ. Indeed, this is the true loss in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I encourage and I remind myself and you, of course, is these are just like helpful guidelines and concepts for us to understand about time and how to invest our time and how to put value, the right value on our time, to realize that time is life. Time is not money. Time is not there to be wasted. Usually, it's interesting that the man-made law would put an injunction on a person who wastes money. They say, no, you're not using this money wisely. Even his own family members, could take them to court and say, my father or my mother or my custodian is wasting this money. They are not thinking clearly. They are not thinking wisely. So therefore, we ask the interference of the judicial system to stop this nonsense. But it's interesting that there are no laws to stop those who waste their lives, those who waste their time. Be it time equals money, right? Which is not true, really, but let's say this is the case. They're wasting their time. Or time equals life, and they're wasting their life. It's interesting that the man-made law does not really put any laws to govern how people ought to use their time. But in Islam, alhamdulillah, we have something called al-hisba. It's a concept, and I will conclude with this concept. It's a concept that in the Muslim world, just like Amir al-Mu'mineen has the obligation to ascertain that no crime is being committed in the society, that there's no mischief, no acts of sinful behavior, no outlaw behavior is being practiced. There's also a hisba, a system in that Amir al-Mu'mineen will place people, on the ground, right, to make sure that the time of Salah comes, everybody's praying. When women go out, they are wearing the proper attire, dress, for a woman. They are not violating the Sharia. Similarly, that no abuse or injustice is taking place on the street. No one is violating, the ibadat. For example, during the month of Ramadan, that no one is eating on the street while they should be fasting. There are people like that, that Amir al-Mu'mineen in a Muslim country ought to have, just like police officers who are preventing crime and protecting the interests of people. These are protecting the interests of people for themselves. Those who are unable to use their time wisely and to invest their time and their life wisely. هذا والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه سبحانك وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا أسأل الله أن نكون ممن قال فيهم قوموا مغفورين لكم اللهم آمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Well, yeah.